This is me, and this is my mate Marty, and we like cars. Lots of cars. We love buying them, fixing them, modifying them, racing them, and even destroying them. We've driven cars in countries all over the world, but now we're setting our sights on our very own backyard, the Australian Outback. We'll be starting in Sydney on the East Coast and travelling west to one of the most desolate and dangerous places on the planet, Central Australia. And to get there, we're going to try and borrow cars from people we meet along the way. This is Lend Us a Ride, Australia. Previously on Lend Us a Ride Australia, we wrangled our way into a rally and set a world record for the slowest time ever on this stage of the Sydney to London rally. Our Capri finally died. We tried to walk to Broken Hill and instead we made a camp in a dried riverbed. Eventually, we got our hands on a Nissan GTR and successfully made our way towards Adelaide without getting arrested.
Adelaide is Australia's fifth largest city and the capital of South Australia. There's 1.3 million people here. It's got beaches, churches, and it gets really hot in summer. Adelaide is known as the City of Churches. Ironically, according to the 2011 census, it is one of the least religious cities in Australia. It's often named as one of the most livable cities in both Australia and the entire world. Adelaide's got some beautiful beaches, including this one, which has less backpackers and bodily fluids than you'll find at Bondi. Yep, there's lots to love about Adelaide.
I love all the crispy, fresh air and all the nice parks and all that kind of stuff.
Very crispy.
You know what I don't like? Not having a car.
No.
This is cool, but I want to do this. Like, you can't sit across Australia in a park.
Well, I mean, it's not called sit in Adelaide, is it?
No.
I mean, that's not the goal.
No.
What I was thinking was, is that because we've got no car and we don't know anybody here, we just jump on Facebook and make a public post and say, we're sitting down here in this car park, and if you want to lend us a car, come down and then we'll pick which car we like the best and then we'll go.
Awesome.
Let's do that.
All right.
So we made a Facebook post and exactly 57 seconds later, the cars started turning up. When we say 57 seconds, we're not joking. It was literally 57 seconds after posting our Facebook message that we heard the first car rumble into the car park. Adelaide was originally designed in a grid to make it easy to get around, and it's known as the 20-minute city because apparently you can get from one point in the city to any other point within 20 minutes. I guess that makes Sydney the 200-minute city. Soon we had heaps of people and heaps of cars, but the one thing we'd neglected to mention on the Facebook post was that the reason that they were there was so we could borrow one of their cars to take to the Outback.
So we have travelled from Sydney to Adelaide completely by only borrowing people's cars. We left Sydney with nothing and we've made our way to Adelaide. It's so amazing for us to like come to a city, like literally an hour ago there's no one here and we're like, can you come down? It probably would have been nice if we said, but the reason we're asking you is we want to take your car to the Outback. That probably would have been nice. And, so here we are in Adelaide now and we have no car. What we're wondering is who is willing to lend us their car?
Yes.
As the hands went up, we realised that we had the automotive equivalent of an all-you-can-eat buffet, and it was time for Marty and I to decide which car we were going to take. We went back to the group and met Graham, who's going to lend us his ride all the way to Port Augusta, and then one of his mates is going to drive him up there to pick it up.
Yes. Welcome aboard this crazy train. Welcome aboard.
Ha ha!
This is a 2000 model Mazda RX-7. It's got a rotary engine and two turbos that operate sequentially, one for low and one for high revs. This car won Playboy's Car of the Year in 1993 when it first came out, and even the Australian police have used them in the past. Around 70,000 of these were produced. This particular one is a Series 8, the final series and only available in Japan. This particular one was later imported into Australia.
You've always wanted one of these RX-7s, haven't you? Proper rotary madness.
Yeah, and this is the way to do it as well. It's the 2000 model, it's the FD. It's just done perfectly. It's black, it's low, it's clean, it's not messed with and ruined like some cars end up being. I love it.
And this is the Japanese version, not just, of course, its spirit, but it's also done in that Japanese style, so it's got really fat, wide tyres, heaps of dish, all the right mods, and making some serious power. It's awesome.
Love it.
Graham, the owner of this RX-7, has done an awesome job on this example. I've always loved these cars. It's a true sports car. It's balanced and it's low slung. Rotary engines are getting rarer, and for all their design brilliance, they won't be replacing piston engines anytime soon. It's a combination that anyone who loves cars should try and experience.
The people of Adelaide were so nice to offer to lend us their cars, and with so many awesome options, it really was not an easy choice. But with an open highway and a modified RX-7, we're both stoked, and now we're continuing towards the Outback.
We've got the RX-7 all the way to Port Augusta, which is about 300 kilometres from Adelaide.
Port Augusta is known as the crossroads of Australia. The town is literally on the edge of the desert and is the last established patch of coastal green foliage to be seen before reaching the Northern Territory. It has a population of approximately 13,000 people, and its major industry is electricity generation and tourism. The most important task for us is to find a car, but we don't know anybody in town, so we're going to hit the local cafe and see if there's anyone there who can lend us a ride.
How are you guys going today?
Good, thanks, and you?
I'm wonderful, thank you.
This is my sister-in-law, she's from Queensland.
Hello, nice to meet you. Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Hello.
Hello.
Now, tell me, what is it that's in the water in Port Augusta that makes you ladies all look so delicious? How long have you lived in Port Augusta?
Do you know how long it takes us to look like this?
I'm assuming not very long. I think you just woke up like that.
Hours.
There's nothing I like more than a woman in tracksuit pants because it means she's fit. We're trying to borrow people's cars to get across Australia, and I'm wondering if
and
you ladies...
how's that going?
Well, we're in Port Augusta, so it's going pretty well. But we're wondering if you ladies had any cars that you could possibly lend us.
Not.
No.
I've got a bomb, but it's got a hole in the sump, so that's no good to you.
Oh, that's no good?
No.
Is there...
And I've got my husband's car. You can take that if you like, but he might come chasing you.
Good luck.
Look at you guys, driving the men crazy every minute of the day, no doubt.
Yeah, better believe it.
All revved up and nowhere to drive.
Do you have a car by any chance?
Do you reckon I could borrow it, maybe? You don't have a car.
I don't.
After exhausting all of the options in the cafe, there was only one person left willing to give us a car. This guy, Samma, who's driven Graham up to collect his RX-7. The English translation of the Mercedes-Benz slogan means the best or nothing. And this is certainly the case with this 1989 Mercedes-Benz 230E. The Mercedes-Benz company traces its origins back to 1886 with the invention of the first petrol-powered automobile. This more modern example has a four-cylinder engine and is rear-wheel drive, renowned for reliability and its comfort. These were also available in six-cylinder and even eight-cylinder, four-wheel drive and limousine options. The interior is absolute luxury, with lashings of blue absolutely everywhere, and a feature list that's way ahead of its time and its rivals. Royalty and people of stature loved these cars, not just for their uncompromising quality and safety, but also because they have an imposing and impressive stance on the road. Samma, the owner of this car, has kindly lent it to us for the day, and then he and Graham are going to come and pick it up from a truck stop up north. And we're on our way to Coober Pedy.
I'm so comfortable.
And this is 1989. I've never driven a Mercedes before in my life. This is the first one. It is just pure comfort, and there's so much technology in here that is ahead of its time. It's amazing. And a lot of people say, Mercedes, they're all so snooty and all whatever, but the technology that they research and develop eventually trickles down into your Daihatsus and your Kias and your cheap cars. So for that, we've got to be thankful, really. Yeah.
This is the most comfortable I think I've been in a car on a highway in my entire life.
I'd agree with that.
It's like the seats have springs and they bounce like a bus seat.
Yes, that's right.
And that it's not like it's nice comfy leather and they still grab you a bit. And there's like, we're doing 110 and we're not yelling.
No.
Every other car we've been in pretty much has been like, what?
Very, very quiet. And the whole thing is this plush, deep blue leather. It's just awesome.
The story goes that the three-pointed star that's used by Mercedes represents their principle of motorization on the ground, in the sea, and in the sky. And today, in the desert.
Oh, check this out, man. You ready?
What is it?
Watch.
What am I watching? What is that?
I know.
Why does it do that?
There's a switch for flipping the headrest down.
Why do you want to flip the headrest down?
I don't know. It's a pretty plush car, man. You might get people a bit happy to be in it.
Why do you flip them down?
Maybe they're going to get in the way.
Of what? Oh, do you think it's for...
Well,
do you think it's for romance?
I don't know. It could be for romance.
So, Marty, we're on the Stuart Highway now, which is named after the explorer that went all the way from the southernmost part of Australia all the way to the north, straight through the middle, and then down again. It was a round trip. And we're headed to Cooper Pedy.
And he didn't have no Mercedes either.
No, he didn't.
In this kind of comfort.
He wasn't rolling in comfort. He wasn't flipping his headrest down like we are.
No.
I'm assuming he had some kind of camel. A lot of camels out here, mate. Wild camels, wild horses.
You actually have to be careful you don't hit wild camels as you get further north.
Yeah, that's right. A lot of people seem to be surprised there's camels out here, but the population of them has just exploded because they were brought here, obviously, to help the explorers when they were doing their exploring. I'm going to overtake. My foot is to the floor, and it's not fast.
It's rather heavy, isn't it?
But it is comfortable. That's pretty good. So, Marty, when we drove into South Australia, that guy came and inspected our car.
Yeah.
When we're in the GTR, and like to make sure we got no fruit and veggies. Do you reckon it's the same deal driving into the Northern Territory?
I think it's the same for most states. Like, they have proper inspection stations so people don't, take fruit flies and
So we can't take any of our fruit and veggies over the border?
No.
We got rid of all of our vegetables before we realised that Cooper Pedy actually wasn't on the other side of the border.
It's a bit worrying because the further we get out, the less opportunities there are to actually meet people and borrow stuff. Yeah. My foot is to the floor and I've got to overtake this person and I'm just not getting acceleration, Martin.
It's because of all the luxurious seats. Like your seat is slowing you down, but how comfortable is your
bumper? Okay, I'm around. Look, I think no matter what, Marty, we will be resourceful, we will meet someone.
Yeah.
And we will get a car.
Yeah.
And we will not be walking again.
Graham and Semma are on their way back to Adelaide, and we're left without a car at a truck stop in the middle of nowhere. But we've got a lead on where we might be able to get our next car.
Good afternoon.
Afternoon, mate.
G'day, mate. How you going?
G'day.
This is Peter. He lives behind the truck stop in a small house with his wife, and he's got an interesting hobby, collecting cars that he finds out on the road, and we're hoping he might lend us one.
Well, there's none of them going, but if you can get one going, you're welcome to it.
So you got a lot of different cars here, Peter?
Yeah, the old Beamer here you see first up, that'll never go again.
Where do all these cars come from, Peter?
They get abandoned out on the road after hitting a roof or something like that. And I used to go out and collect them, but I'm just past it now.
And is this a business for you, Peter?
No, not really. I just help people out where it's necessary.
Would you be able to lend us one?
None of them are actually running.
Oh, okay.
Because they've broken down and I just don't repair them anymore.
There are a lot of different cars, but overall it is not looking too promising. One thing's for sure though, every car here has a story.
So Peter, this looks like a 1950s Peugeot 303. How did this one end up here?
Well, it was going and the bloke got a new car and he just parked it here and it's been there ever since.
Wow.
That was one of the types of car that won the Red X trial.
Okay.
Back in those days.
And what about this? Marty and I made our own convertible once actually by angle grinding the roof off an old Mazda. It didn't look too dissimilar to this actually, but I gather this one was kind of maybe in a bit better shape when it got first dropped off here.
Well, the young people that were working in the town brought this up from Melbourne and they decided it was too hot, so they just cut the roof off. Then it stopped working and they dropped it here. Well, the driver of the four-wheel drive that was towing it went off the right-hand side of the road and pulled it back onto the bitumen and overcorrected and rolled it. It was 3 days old out of Canberra.
3 days old?
Yeah, $85,000 worth in matchwood like that.
Unbelievable. Was everybody okay?
Nobody was hurt or even scratched.
Which is crazy, because the damage looks quite severe, doesn't it?
Yeah, the vehicle towing it was written off as well.
Not only do we need the car to run, we also need it to be road registered, so that only leaves us with a couple of possibilities.
See, that would be awesome, but look at it.
What is that thing? Even know. What kind of
Datsun? I don't even know what that logo
Datsun is. Datsun Mazda 323 wagon. That's a Sigma. That is a Gemini. Look at this, man. We could totally make this work.
Oh. We cannot make this work today. Come on, man.
The drive
man.
Shaft is in the engine bay. That's, I don't even know how that happens. If you do a big skid in it.
Wow.
Yeah, maybe not.
This was your first car, wasn't it?
That was my first car ever, except it was bright Kermit green.
Peter loves his cars, but he hates electricity bills, so he's made his own system to go off the grid.
Peter, these solar panels, that doesn't look like a standard mounting system. Is that something you've come up with?
Oh, that's just an old trailer axle with a Ford disc on it and another Ford disc on top. I ran out of room with it.
Yep.
And
Is the idea of this that you can disengage it and rotate the panel?
Yeah, you just push the handle and it turns.
And so does all your electricity for out here come from this rig?
From these group of solar panels, yes.
Completely off the grid?
Totally off the grid. I have a battery system where when you're not generating at night,
yep,
it runs the house for the night time.
So you don't pay a thing for electricity?
Not a red cent.
That's brilliant.
Marty, this one's got rego, mate.
What's that for?
Rego on the four-wheel drive.
Oh, yeah.
There are cars that have been sitting out here for decades, but Peter reckons there might be one or two of the newer ones that will go with a bit of work.
This one belongs to a lady in Alice Springs, actually, and she might come and get it.
Otherwise, maybe we could take it back to her.
Yeah.
Is it broken?
Yeah, it's broken.
This is the one I actually want. Look at this.
Come on, man.
This is unreal. Come on.
Jerry, look at that. Someone's put some time into it.
What happened to this one, Peter?
Ran out of engine. All you'd have to do is put another wheel on it. And,
this is a bad sign, though, Peter. I mean, this sitting here.
That's what went wrong with it.
Okay, all right. So it doesn't have a radiator, doesn't have some wheels. Does it run, as far as you know?
Oh, it's an excellent runner, but as I say, it needs another radiator. If we can't find one in one of these others, you'd have to order one from Port Augusta.
A Falcon's a good car, man, for the desert.
Yeah.
Parts everywhere.
Festiva. No. Small and seized.
I'm normally on that side. I like it. I think this might be our thing.
The number plate's a bit crazy. What does that mean, Peter? Badge 493.
Well, it's Victor Alpha Juliet.
Okay.
Actually.
Ex-Army.
Are you ex-Army, Peter?
15 years of it.
Okay. That'll be a yes. What did you do in the Army?
Official Secrets Act, not allowed to tell you.
Okay.
If I did, I'd have to shoot you.
2 hours later, we're back on the road and we've got ourselves a Ford Falcon.
If you're wondering why there's a zebra crossing out in the middle of nowhere, it's actually because this section of the highway is used as an emergency runway.
Every car kind of seems to seduce these certain emotions out of you.
Yeah.
This feels like the car that we are meant to be on in the Outback.
I have to say, like, I feel the exact same way. The inside is even the colour of the Outback.
Yeah.
Like, it's all sand coloured. And I actually think this is, in some ways, this is an Australian icon. Like, forget who Ford's owned by, any of that stuff. It's like, this is built for Australia. Like, that's what this car exists. Like, what we're doing now is the reason it was built.
Exactly. And I'm going to say, even though this car is from 1986, it's doing its job perfectly, as well as it would have when it rolled out of the production in day one.
Yep.
Because there's no frills. You got four dials along the front here for your temperature. You've got a cassette player.
Yep.
You've got a slush box. That's it. Other than that, you've got lounge kind of chair. And this is big. I mean, this distance between us.
Yep. It just does everything you need for this kind of driving.
Yeah. The only thing that it doesn't do, Martin, you know what it doesn't do? have a look down there at the little red light.
You mean the one that's flashing?
The flashing red light that's an oil can. Yeah, so what it doesn't do
is make oil pressure.
Is make oil pressure. So that there is maybe potentially a problem, but Peter back there said to us, as long as you stay under 2,500 RPM, he reckons we'll get another 50,000 Ks out of it.
Well, that's good.
If we go over 2,500 RPM, he reckons we'll get 50 Ks out of it.
Right, well, we need 1,000 Ks minimum.
Exactly.
Is how far we have to go.
Yes.
All right, so drive sensibly, that's easy.
Exactly.
We've got low oil pressure and our car is overheating. We are literally in the middle of nowhere. It's completely deserted and night is closing in fast, which means dingoes, yowies and bunyips. So we're going to push on and try and make our way to Cooper Pedy. Hopefully if we make it, we can try and fix our car. Otherwise, we're going to have to find another one once we get there.